Let's go to Luke chapter 18, and next week, God willing, we'll be doing the 19th chapter of Luke, and you all know that the 19th chapter of Luke is the place to start with evangelism with your friends. Luke 19 verse 11 is absolutely classic. We'll get to it next week. But Luke 18 is on prayer. And as I read these words, I think, my goodness, this rabbi was a powerful teacher. It really makes you think. So I'll read 18:1 of Luke. Luke wrote probably 33% of the New Testament, vastly important. 18:1 says this. Now Jesus was telling them a parable to show that at all times they ought to pray and not to lose heart.
Saying, in a certain city there was a judge who did not fear God and did not respect man.
In the same town there lived a widow who time and again went to the judge saying, give me justice in the case against my opponent.
Mm-hmm. For a while, he did not want to do anything about it. But eventually, he said to himself, even though I do not respect God or care about anyone, this widow is so annoying. I will make sure she receives justice. Then she will not wear me out, coming to see me so often.
Six. And the Lord said?
Then the Lord said, learn a lesson from this evil judge. Mm-hmm.
Now, will not God bring about justice for his elect, who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them?
I tell you that he will bring about justice for them quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?
All right, that's a staggering piece of scripture, isn't it? What do you make of that? It's a clever argument, isn't it? So you take the worst possible scenario, a judge who doesn't care about God, he couldn't care less about justice or man. Even he responds eventually if you wear him out, right? Even he, it's a famous Hebrew way of arguing, how much more will God, who is righteous, who does care about justice, how much more will he finally act? Isn't that good? I think it's a clever way to argue. You say, well, look how bad that is, you know, wait a minute. God is none of those bad things, but he will eventually answer and not delay. Although it appears in your prayer life often that God does delay. So I really relate to this. I think this is very powerful. I would have been sitting on the front row listening to this very carefully. He was telling them a story, a parable. Paravali in Greek means you throw one thing next to the other. You've heard of a ball, you throw it. Valu in Greek. Para, alongside. So you throw this thing alongside that. You say, look at this, life is like a bowl of cherries. Or not, depending on your mood. It's a parable. It's a really lovely, realistic way to do it. Very non-philosophical. You see, it's not spacey and philosophical. It's very real. Life is like whatever. Here, then, a parable. And Jesus did many of them because he spoke to ordinary folk who didn't need some brain-breaking philosophical argument about the meaning of one. Jesus would have said, one means one. Come on, let's not argue about the word one. That's easy. Your child of two knows that even. Okay, so there's a parable, here it is, to show his point in teaching this was that all times they ought to pray and not to lose heart. I mean, there's enough there for hours of meditation. Isn't it? You're not supposed to give up. You have to pray at all times, and you're not to give up. So then he illustrates it in a nice way. There was, in a certain city, it doesn't say what, there was a judge who didn't fear God and didn't respect man. Well, the audience would have been smiling, wouldn't they? They'd have thought, yeah, I know judges like that. When they heard that, many of them would have thought, well, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. We know judges who don't care about God. I know there were good judges too, but in a certain city unnamed, there was a judge who did not fear God and did not respect man. I'm thinking that we as Christians in training to judge the world would better be the very opposite of this. We better fear God very much, and we better very much care about men, and we better be the very opposite from this sloppy judge who did a rotten job. So there was a widow, and we are kind of widows, you know, in Galatians, where the church is small and reduced, but our time is coming when we're going to be massive in the kingdom. But we're like a widow in that city. She kept coming to him saying, give me legal protection for my opponent. Give me justice. Have you ever prayed? We need justice in this guy. I do, I think. There's some terrible injustices I see. You just cry out. For justice to be done seems so unfair the way it's being done. For a while, this careless judge was unwilling, But finally, he said to himself, even though I do not fear God, like the way Jesus repeats that, even the judge said, I don't care about God, I don't care about justice, but this woman is really bothering me, she's annoying me, so what I'm going to do is give her the justice she's asking for. I'll give her legal protection. Otherwise, by continually coming to me, she's going to be wearing me out. That reminds me of Daniel 7, where it says that the Antichrist is trying to wear you out. Wear you down. That's the way. The saints are being worn down by the Antichrist in chapter 7 of Daniel. Okay, any comments on any of that, Carlos, at all? Anybody want to add to that? Self-explanatory, I think.
No, they're just talking about the weather.
It sounds quite topical with our concern politically for judges, for righteous judges, with the absence of Justice Scalia.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it's pretty appalling. This was more than a sloppy judge. He was an evil judge, according to my translation.
Yep.
And it reminds me of Amos 5:24, where it is said, I want to see a mighty flood of justice.
It's a great verse.
Oh, this is so fantastic.
Yeah.
Especially for those who question
Amos 5:24,
who question ruling in the kingdom. Are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. You don't want to see and be a part of a mighty flood of justice?
Mm. Absolutely.
To me, this is everything.
Right. I think we should go back and look at the verses there in Amos 5. I'm starting at 21. Here's God speaking. Listen to God speaking in Amos 5:21. I reject your festivals. I can't stand your church meetings. I cannot stand them, God says. This is Amos 5:21. I don't delight in your solemn assemblies. So religion just for the sake of getting a group together can be an appalling thing to God. Even though, verse 22, you offer up to me burnt offerings, you do all the stuff you're supposed to do, and grain offerings, I will not accept them. This is pretty amazing, isn't it? I, God, am not impressed with your religion at all. I will not even look at the peace offerings of your fatlings. My goodness, that's powerful. 23, take away from me the noise of your awful songs. I'm thinking of the Jesus is my boyfriend choruses, which I don't like either. They're very sloppy and very popular and very non-strengthening. Jesus is my boyfriend choruses, I'm against them. Jesus is not your boyfriend. He's to be taken seriously as your rabbi and teacher. So Jesus, God said this in 23, take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not even listen to the sound of your harps. The kinnor is the little harp that the Hebrews had, the modern Hebrew word for a violin, incidentally. They've taken the word for harp and called it a violin in modern times. I will not even listen to the sound of your harps. Now 24 is the verse that Barbara talked about. But let justice roll down like waves, and righteousness, getting it things right rather than wrong, let righteousness be like an overflowing stream. Isn't that amazing? Just massive, just rolling on like huge waves breaking over everything. Isn't that a wonderful image? I don't know how people could put the Bible down, by the way. I think it's absolutely fascinating. What a clever way to explain a theological point.
So if we go back a little bit further,
yes, go back.
15 is very profound.
What does it say?
Hate evil and love what is good. Remodel your courts into true halls of justice.
Wow, remodel your courts
into
true halls of justice. I mean, Barbara's working on the abortion issue, and that cries out for justice. There's those little mites in the womb who cannot even cry out or speak. Chop them up and sell the body parts. Come on now. This is awful stuff, because the wrath of God will come over the world eventually like the flood. How many people survived the flood? 8 people. Wait a minute. Watch out. We better repent and be right with God, because God is a God of justice. And that's the point, I think, of this parable on prayer. Okay, so that took us, it's a typical way to do good Bible study, by the way. Take your marginal reference or some other connecting point, go back and read Amos, and think, my goodness, this is great. Then you go to Proverbs and you find that God hates people who bless good. And he hates people. He does. He hates them. It says that. God hates some people. It does actually say that. He's not pleased with people who bless what is evil. And he's not at all pleased with people who curse what is good. Both are said in Proverbs 24 to be an abomination. Isn't that amazing? So we better get it right. You're right in the middle, you're doing fine. On this side, you're wrong. That side, you're also wrong. Very challenging. I suppose, as Barbara said, see, all this makes good sense, because if we're in training to rule the world, 1 Corinthians 6:2, don't you know the saints are going to manage the world, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 2. Don't you know, Paul says, in a fit of indignation, when they're taking each other to court in the church, he says, this is ridiculous. Don't you know the saints are going to govern the world, manage the world? And you mean you can't even solve a little problem in the church between yourselves? What is this? I can sense Paul's tone of voice that was very indignant. So justice is something we'd better be in favor of.
And lovers of. Not lovers of truth, but right. We have to love justice.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Because God loves justice. There was a story last night about a dog that had been taken and had a lead weight, a sort of concrete weight, hung around its neck, and its mouth was taped shut. It was a real story locally. And some person found this animal and freed it, and it found a home. I thought, that person doesn't deserve to live. Can you imagine that? And it's just doing it to a dog even. But that happened in Georgia, right here in Atlanta last night. That is going to stop. People will not be able to do that level of cruelty. Anyway, one could go on about that.
Yes. Isaiah 29:13. Someone.
Okay, let's go back there. Isaiah 29. Somebody suggests a parallel verse, maybe.
And the Lord said, "Because these people draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service, but they remove their hearts far from me, and their reverence for me consists of tradition learned by rote."
Yeah, by heart. By heart. That's in Isaiah 29:13. You'll find in teaching you want to try to repeat verses. People don't catch it the first time round. And 29:13, Isaiah, then Adonai said, the Lord God, because this people, talking to the people of Israel at that time, at any time where this might apply, they draw near, they come to church with their words, they honor God with their lip service, but their heart, their mind is far removed from me. They just don't have a clue. Their reverence for me consists of traditions learned by heart. They mutter this creed without any idea what it means. They go to church, they say, "We believe in the Son of God who is begotten but not made." What? Begotten, not made. That's in the creed. Do they know what that means? No. Does God care? Yes. This is churches where you're supposed to understand what you're doing. So it's learned by heart, but it has no meaning. And God responds in verse 14 here of Isaiah 29. "Therefore, behold, I will once again deal marvelously with these people. I will wondrously and marvelously deal with them. And the wisdom of their PhDs, may I say, and their lying scholars, the wisdom of their wise, so-called, will perish. And the discernment of their so-called discerning will be concealed." Isn't that interesting? So, powerful stuff. Now then, let's go back to where we were. Anything else, Carlos? Everybody feeling duly chastised?
Randy says our persistence in prayer and faith is encouraged in light of the coming of the Lord Jesus at the end of the age, the day of the Lord.
Absolutely. Randy note has the good language there, the end of the age, not the end of time. Time doesn't stop when Christ comes back. He introduces a new age, still time. That's the end of the age, the day of the Lord, God's intervention, Yahweh's intervention, using his agent, the Son, to deal with the world in a very decisive way. Very good.
Can I ask about imprecatory prayers?
Yeah, of course.
Which fill a lot of the Psalms of David.
Yeah, some of the Psalms. A few.
When Jesus commands prayer, that we pray as much as possible. Mm. What should be the content of our prayers? If you pray as the psalmist did, a lot of the times for example, I'm reading Psalm 35.
Yeah.
"Content Yahweh for those who contend with me. Fight against those who fight against me."
Yeah. That's difficult question. In the New Testament, there is an element of non-violence that you don't have in David. This is quite true. In David, for instance, there was a man of war. He was a warrior, and God told him to go and kill people. sometimes he killed wrongly, but he was a man of war. And for that reason, he wasn't allowed to build the temple. Very important. He wasn't somehow quite at the top level in that field. Although David is mentioned more than Jesus in the Bible, over 1,000 times, he's massively important. But his bloody hands in wartime prevents him from being the builder of the temple. That Solomon did that. Jesus did. So there's some element there in the plan of God which is less than perfection in terms of violence in the case of David. He gets the New Testament, you'll love your enemies. However, Jesus, let me remind you, says at his second coming, bring my enemies in front of me and kill them. Jesus said that. That's not a popular verse. That's at the second coming. For the moment now, we'd better be rather non-violent. We'd better be non-resisting. It doesn't mean that we are waffly in terms of justice. We can certainly pray for justice.
The reason I ask is because in this story, the woman is making an imprecatory demand from this king. Similar to the psalmist. So, so in relation to us now, looking 2,000 years down the road, would such prayers still?
Well, you get your justice eventually. I don't know that we can get justice now. There's a text in Ecclesiastes that says the problem with the world is that justice doesn't step in. That's the problem. So you can still pray, oh God, come back, Jesus, come back, please settle these issues. Please let's see justice done. Jesus is going to do that. Right now, then, you have rather the opposite approach. This is before the second coming, because James and John said, why don't we call down fire and burn these people up. Remember? They didn't accept Jesus. And then he says, you don't know what kind of spirit you're supposed to be of, so don't do that. We don't do that. So there's a contrast. In the Old Testament, violence was actually prescribed. It was ordered. On one occasion, God said, kill the whole lot of them. They were so corrupt, they didn't deserve to live. However, in the New, we'd better have a non-imprecatory style. At least for now. However, in the future, it's proper that justice be something like that, I think. It requires some balanced thinking. Not easy. Then he says, this one is very powerful. The Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge said in verse 6. Now, will not God bring about justice for his elect? He will. There's the answer. He will indeed bring about justice for his elect, who cry to him day and night. And will he delay long over them? Well, it might seem like that. He seems to go on waiting and waiting. People have been expecting the second coming forever. You know that. 1850, William Miller, in 1844, actually, to be precise, October the 21st or whatever, he said, Christ has come back. It was a ghastly miscalculation. People went out on the mountains to wait for Jesus, and they gave up their jobs. This is 1844, known as the Great Disappointment. Since that time, people have always set dates wrongly. It seems to go on and on. There's a delay. Verse 8, though, Jesus sums this up rather nicely. Let me tell you this, that God will bring about justice, he will, speedily, in the sense that that doesn't mean next week or even the week after, but ultimately, decisively, justice will be done. But then he says, when the Son of Man comes, that's himself, will he in fact find the faith on the earth? The Greek there is the faith, suggesting not just faith, it doesn't make a big difference, but will the true faith actually be there? It doesn't sound as though he expects trillions and trillions of people to have the faith, so that's a challenge for us. Will he find the faith? Jesus is a pessimist at this point, right? He looks at human nature and he says that we, sees that we are, what's the adjective we try to find there, sort of predictably wrong, right? If the human race is going to get it wrong, you get it wrong. Give them half a chance, they'll mess it up. That's who we are, right? So looking at the state of religion, he's obviously wondering, is this faith even going to survive? How long? If at all. He didn't know. As we know, there are some faithful people at the second coming. There are. There will be. Caught up to meet the Lord as he comes in his one single post-tribulation event, catching up to meet the Lord, escort him to the earth. Okay. Good topics.
Can I make a point about the Son of Man, which I was looking into this week? I sent you a paper on this. It's used, it's the most used self
Self-designation of Jesus, 80 times of himself. He's the human being. Yes. Right.
Self-identifier, like, yeah. And it simply means a human being,
yes.
A man, and it comes from mostly Jewish, what they call Jewish apocalyptic visions, like Daniel and Enoch.
Yep.
Ezekiel
also is called the Son of Man, right?
And just the point I want to make is that it strikes me that it's never applied to God.
No, of course.
Or an angel.
No.
And actually, in the book of Enoch,
yeah.
from which a lot of scholars say Daniel borrows or whatever, it actually contrasts angels with this figure, Son of Man. In other words, he cannot possibly be an angel. So I threw out this question in the social networks about people who believe Jesus was an angel or anything other than a human being, that it's very striking, or it should be, that 82 times, according to the New International Dictionary, the Gospels use this title, Son of Man, for Jesus, or he uses it for himself. So,
so he is. I mean, Acts 7, Stephen sees the Son of Man standing at the right hand of the Father. It means the human being. So guess what? It doesn't mean God, because God's not a human being. That's not even an argument. Guess what? It's not an angel, because an angel is not a human being. That should be the end of it. But the scholars like to, you know, let's do all the detail on it. Nothing wrong with that. On the other hand, let's not make it more complicated than it is.
Well, it is, though. That's why we have to help.
We have to help.
These millions of people who think Jesus was an angel, was a little G God, was God himself. Yeah. You know, there's a verse I found in the Bible Works, which... it's from the Book of Wisdom of Jewish literature. It says, for all things cannot be in man, because the Son of Man is not immortal.
Of course not.
Now, that's a very striking verse to me, because...
Son of Man is not... No, human beings are not immortal. That's another lie of Greek philosophy.
Exactly. It sort of brings in these two sort of lines of lies that have...
It should be easy enough to say human beings are born, God is not born, angels are not born, that's it.
It should be.
It should be. But you have to go on saying that over and over again.
But because that Son of Man term is foreign to our language, would it would more people get it, you know, those 80 plus times?
If they translated it,
human being.
Of course. Does any translation do that? I think I may have done that.
I've forgotten.
Sure,
because of the multitude of times it's mentioned. And when they are reading Son of Man, they're hearing something quite else than man.
Well, I like some translations, just to speak to that quickly. I actually like the translation of 1 Timothy 2:5, which is another, or should be.
Yeah.
I think it's the today's New International Version. That says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and human beings, Jesus,
the
man. And then the translation says, himself human.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Yeah.
So, some do, I think.
In a note, certainly in my translation, one God, the Father, one man, Messiah, Son of Man, explained from Daniel 7. It's actually not difficult. It's become difficult because of the confusion. But especially if you point out that Ezekiel is called Son of Man. He's addressed as sort of representing human beings in some way, but he didn't think he was God, Ezekiel didn't think he was an angel, so that's just absurd. God, you see, doesn't get born, and God cannot die. Your child of two knows that, but we don't know that. When we go to church, we abandon common sense and come up with all sorts of strange things.
Well, it was also in my head, because I just watched this debate.
Yeah.
And the opposing person was a bit tricky, because they didn't want to say that they were Aryans, they were pre-existence. They didn't want to say, oh, he was an angel. Mm-hmm. So this person would say, no, he's not an angel, he's not God. He was the Word.
Yes.
The Word, that's it, the Word. Mm-hmm. But again, if you're looking at these apocalyptic visions of the Son of Man, a human being, actually, I'll just read your translation to people here. Namely, this is your translation, the only one we use in this
one. We use lots of translations.
Oh, sorry.
Lots of translations.
The cat's out of the bag.
No, we don't. No.
There's
which verse are you in?
1 Timothy 2:5.
Right.
There is one. I like this one. There is one God.
Yeah.
And one mediator between the one God and man, Messiah Jesus, who is Himself a man.
Of course.
Amen.
Yeah. I just mean it was perfectly obvious. It was perfectly obvious in any translation. One God, one mediator, and God and man, the man Jesus Christ. That should be enough. But because people are so confused, you have to sort of lay it on the line. A man himself, a man, anthropos. So Randy liked this, our good friend Randy out there, he liked this, we mentioned in the Q&A on Friday. The Bible is about God and man. It's not about God and God. That's the whole deal. It's God's gracious offer to give mortal man immortality. You don't offer immortality to someone who's already immortal. And God is one person. So the whole book is about God and man. That's Psalm 110:1, Yahweh and Adonai, my Lord, little L. Not about God and God, much less God and God and God. Not even God and God.
God and God and God and God.
No, 1.5 billion Muslims are cringing when we say Trinity. And the Quran says, desist, you people of the book, you Christians. Shut up. Don't say three gods. Don't say that. No, God is only one. They've got that right. We should get it right too, because Jesus obviously believed in unitary monotheism. If that's not right, throw the Bible out, it has no meaning at all.
And so, I'm thinking, if you are not Catholic and don't have Mary as your mediator,
right,
and if you are an evangelical Christian who is believing that Jesus is God, you have no mediator.
That's right. That's right. You've lost your mediator.
I find that staggering.
Yeah.
Well, the question asked by a good pastor in Managua, Nicaragua, Alex Davila, he has a radio show every week in Spanish in Nicaragua. He does great work. And he asked the people that the question
he
came
up
with.
Point on the radio yesterday.
So he asked people, can someone call it? Oh, the only response, because sometimes the phones don't work, they're a poor country. This woman called up, and she just said, oh, I believe in Jesucristo, Jesus Christ, she was a JW, by the way. So, Randy says, button this issue, could the Son of Man, can we also translate that as the Son of Adam, a human being?
Of course. All human beings are sons of Adam, they're all descendants of Adam, we're all from Adam, of course, fine, human being, son of Adam. That's perfectly right. Now, if you don't think that he's the man mediator, then the Roman Catholics say, well, since we know he's God, he couldn't be the mediator, then let's then move Mary into that position. You see, it's sort of musical chairs thing, isn't it? You take Jesus out of his right position, say, well, Mary will do, she's the mediatrix. She's officially the mediatrix. She's alive and well at the right hand of the Father, and she's interceding, because after all, see, Jesus is a man, and he might be rather foreign to what you want done, but a woman has a soft heart. So Mary is a very nice figure to have up there. Well, she happens to be dead, I have to say to my Roman Catholic friends. She's dead, so you're wasting your time. The Bible says that the man Messiah is there. He knows all about being a human being because he was one. He understands us, and God has graciously provided him. Okay, you can go on about these other religions. Mary, of course, did have normal relationships with her husband after the birth of Jesus. Oh no, so Catholic. Oh no, she wouldn't do that, would she? We don't want that. Oh no. So then the brothers, so-called, must in fact not be brothers at all. They're cousins. Now, there are only a million or so Roman Catholics out there who believe that. What are you doing to help them? My point. What are we doing to help them? So they turn brothers into cousins.
Don't they also have the saints as mediators?
Saints are also mediators. Yes. You can see in the newspaper, pray to St. Jude. The saints are also dead. The dead are dead. So you're wasting your time. Save your money on the candles. Don't light candles to Mary. She's not alive. She's not listening. The saints are dead. Wasting your time. Talk to Messiah. Talk to the Father. And you have fulfilled the requirements of Scripture, as far as we can see.
What's the candles for? When they go in and light?
Well, it's a sort of form of incense, the smoke, I suppose.
I've seen in movies and stuff where the person goes in and there are a bunch of candles.
Oh, yes.
Oh, is that
incense? I suppose, yes. I think it's the incense that goes from the fire. It's a form of incense. You want that to go up into the nostrils.
It represents the prayer to the saints.
Yep, prayer to the saints. Yeah. Oh, yes, that must be it. Okay, moving on. Pharisees and the publican. Let's do this one now. The Pharisee is the symbol of established religion, not very good in Jesus' day, and the publican who did better. What about this? Who's got nine?
You.
Me. And he also told this story, this parable, to some people who trusted in themselves that they were right, righteous, and viewed others with contempt.
Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Mm-hmm.
The Pharisee stood up and prayed to himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, cheats, criminals, adulterers, or even like this tax collector.
Yeah.
I fast twice a week and I pay tithes on my income.
But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, O God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner.
Yeah. I tell you, this man went to his house right rather than wrong, justified rather than the other guy. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. He who humbles himself will be exalted. Okay, stop there. It's a self-evident lesson, isn't it?
It's interesting. It's a contrast between the imprecatory-like prayer of the woman and the sort of now prayer we should be doing, I guess.
Well, this is a lesson about not exalting yourself, quite obviously, and that's not a good idea. But, of course, God has decided to exalt the faithful. There are other parables and stories where Jesus said, be humble now, and God will exalt you. So there is a proper exaltation, that's fine, but there's a wrong exaltation when you're thinking you're just better than everybody else on earth. That clearly is wrong. So people make mistakes in Bible studies. They say, well, what about this verse over here? Wait a minute, that's a different category. There are tons of verses which say, seek exaltation, seek to be great, seek to be elevated. That's fine. That's one category. Now there's another category which says, don't seek to be elevated. Two different areas of thinking, right? You have to work that out. People say, well, maybe that's a contradiction. No, no, no. It's a different category of thinking. You think here, and then you think in a different field over here. So then he goes on with the babies. We're getting to that in a moment. But verse 14, I want to point out, the word justified means you're right rather than wrong. That's all that is. All these theological arguments about justification. When you do typing, you justify the right margin. You make it straight. You want to be straight rather than crooked. You want to be right rather than wrong. That's all that is. The famous text in Genesis 15, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as making him right. I love that. Abraham said, well, I don't think that's right, God. No, I don't think it's too difficult. It's too difficult. No, he believed what God said, and God said, you're my person. You're my man or woman. I can deal with you because you are actually generous enough to believe God when he speaks. Isn't that amazing? That's being right rather than wrong. I love that because it's so complicated in the theological argumentation. All right, so the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus modeled that. We know that, right? Washing their feet, humbled himself. Philippians 2, he was in the form of God. He had the status of God, Philippians 2, but he didn't exercise that right of authority. He could have told the whole world what to do as king. He didn't. He decided to wash their feet, to model humility. That's amazing. He even says that God in heaven humbles himself to look at men. God comes down and sees what's going on. So God is humble in that way too. Okay, anything else there?
Just to go back a bit.
Okay.
A question. I think you said something about when we were talking about Catholics.
Yeah.
You should just ask Jesus. So the question is about prayer to Jesus.
Oh, yes.
And can you point to one or other verses?
Where absolutely. Prayer to Jesus is valid. John 14:14, don't read the King James, corrupted version in that text, but in 14:14, well attested in the Greek manuscripts, Jesus said, if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. John 14:14. Secondly, in 2 Timothy, Paul thanked Messiah for putting him in ministry. That's a form of prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for doing this. That's perfectly fine. The other one would be 1 Corinthians chapter 1, where it says, 1 Corinthians 1 says, all of those who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, appeal to the name of Jesus. That calling upon is a Yahweh thing in the Old Testament. You call upon the name of Yahweh, And here in the New, you call on the Lord Jesus Messiah. That's in verse 2. Church of God in Corinth, those who have been sanctified in Messiah Jesus, saints by calling, 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 2, with all who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. I think that's very clear. I know that most prayer is offered to the Father through the Messiah. I see that entirely, but there, again, let's not be so wooden. You know, oh, I just want this, but not that. No, no, relax a little bit. You can talk to Jesus. When he was on the earth, people begged him. This dear woman said, look, my child is demon-possessed. Please help me. He didn't. She had to win that argument. Remember that wonderful thing? The lady from Tyre and Sidon. She won the argument. Finally, Jesus conceded. So plead with God, plead with Jesus sometimes. Why not? Seems to be a marvelous freedom, actually.
There's an interesting comment here that in John 15, 16,
yes.
Whatever you ask
yes.
of the Father in my name,
yes.
he may give it to you.
Yes.
I don't know if this is right, but since you're a grammarian,
mm-hmm.
the commentator says that it can also be, I may give
yes.
you.
No difference. If you ask anything, yeah, I said I may give it to you. You can pray to the Father, that's clear. But you can also, John 14, 14, pray to Jesus. If you ask me, Jesus, anything by name, I'll do it. Relax, easy. Don't need any grammar. We don't need any details. Just, you know, these are easy facts, I think. Okay. Most translations will get that right. Not the King James, though, in John 14, 14.
I think the issue is that the translations... Uh-huh. maybe don't help because they render the prayer language as ask.
Yes.
So people disconnect the two. So it says, oh, it doesn't say prayer. I want to see prayer. You know?
I see. So asking God for something is not the same as praying to God for
Or when we say the phrase calling on the name is a very well-known Old Testament prayer language.
Perfectly right.
But people who have been indoctrinated perhaps in systems, they go, no, it doesn't specifically say prayer. You know, maybe that's also the issue.
I think they do, but that is frankly the legalistic approach to the Bible that I'm trying to overcome here.
Well, it could be plain ignorance, because
it's sheer ignorance, but we're trying to recover from ignorance. I don't think it's that difficult. You can pray to Jesus. I grant that most of the prayers are offered to the Father through Jesus, but relax. These dear people talk to Jesus, the blind men, say, hey, Jesus, come and heal us, please. And you mean when he's gone to heaven now you can't talk to him? That's absurd. I will comment, though, on the way international people. They thought that Jesus, they thought that Jesus couldn't even hear what's going on. They thought he was so human, he doesn't even know what's going on. That's absolutely false. And Dan Gill showed us nicely that in the Old Testament, God's eyes are watching everywhere, searching the hearts. Well, guess what? In Revelation, Jesus is searching the hearts. Is it clear? And then in Acts you have, is it Aeneas? God, Jesus is healing you. Jesus is healing you. So Jesus is very active. He knows exactly what's going on.
Isn't he still the head of the church?
I would think he's the head of the church.
And therefore very, very involved.
Yes. I like Sarah came up with a good phrase this week. Shared titles. God is the Savior. Jesus is also Savior. But in the book of Nehemiah, the saviors were the judges. You've got saviors at different levels. You've only got one absolute savior. I get it. Is this harder than, well, we know the president is the one in the White House, but you have the president of the local bank. We're going to argue about that? No. Let's not argue about that. Seems to me sometimes the Bible is, well, let's not dissect it to the point of making it difficult.
Well, how is he our mediator? If you can't...
Of course.
I mean, where do you find, again, I go back to, I think... It could be an ignorance thing or a play on words. We're defining, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, asking and calling on, right?
Yes.
So ask Jesus, calling on Jesus, call on Jesus.
Yeah.
Well, we're defining that as prayer language.
Yes, of course
prayer, I'm praying to Jesus.
Right.
But the problem, again, I go back, is to the church, to the Catholic Protestant system that is bringing people up in, like, disconnecting what shouldn't be disconnected.
Well, we're trying to overcome that.
Right, so...
Trying to free the air a little bit, make it easier for people. Okay, let's go on with this. This is good stuff. Then we get more lessons on humility. This is beautiful materials. Who's got 17? 15. They were bringing even their babies to him so that he would touch them. But when the disciples saw it, they began rebuking. See, these disciples were much too legalistic, by the way. I will get to that.
Well, they were Jews.
Say that. That's racist. Okay, they were rebuking them. 16. What about 16?
But Jesus called for them, saying, "Permit the children to come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these."
Wonderful. 17, please.
I tell you the truth, or amen. Anyone who does not welcome the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter.
Good. All right, let's stop there. That is terrific. Let me tell you, on the authority of God, amen, I'm telling you. Verse 17. Whoever doesn't receive, welcome, accept, agree with, get on board with the kingdom of God as God's great immortality plan, like a child, we'll not enter it. You've got to accept the program to be part of it. Let's say, "God, I'm so thrilled you're having a kingdom. I'm so excited that that's the program. You're inviting me to be a king in your kingdom. Wow, isn't this great? I accept it, like a child." And said, "Well, let's pause the Greek word before I accept. Let's not. Let's just say, accept it. Not a problem, but we do have a lot of work because people have not been instructed in all of this. Like a child." Didn't he just call the babies? And how young were the babies? 2 years old, I suppose. Something like that. Let the little ones, and I think we all of us have this marvelous vision that if you tell of a child, if you tell a child the moon is made of cheese, that child will believe it because you're the authority. I'm not suggesting we'd be gullible. Oh, by the way, talking of gullibility, you should sign up for Wally Winner's dot-to-dot prophecy thing, 20 issues a year, I think. He's done an excellent thing on gullibility this month. It's very, very good. I sent him a note to thank him for that. But we as a human race tend to be very gullible. We believe anything in us, any of those authorities say, is that person. So let's not be gullible. On the other hand, let's not be so clever that we've got to argue everything. Let's just accept the truth. It's simple. So that's a great verse 17, isn't it?
Actually, this week,
evangelism,
I quoted this verse to the person because they kept saying, "Look, we can't know God, you know, you can't reduce it to he's one or God." You know, he was fighting the relativism of the, you know, this philosophical sort of thing that God, God is not an actual father, is he? Or God is not actually a man. And I'm like, "No, look, we're talking about how many God is," and so on. And he says, at the end, the person said, "Oh, look, you're being too simplistic about it."
Yeah, of course.
And I quoted in this verse, I said, "Well, guess what? Jesus said you have to become like a little child to understand."
What this man is missing is that God has decided to reveal himself in Scripture.
Exactly.
God has decided. So, Father, so you're attacking. Right. See how clever that is.
Right. You're attacking the Scripture. The language.
I want to be more philosophical than the Bible. Don't outdo God. God speaks to us in language that's intelligible.
Well, I kept saying, "Look, Jesus calls him Father."
Of course. Isn't that good?
He says, "Yeah, but he's not man. He's not a father." And I said, "Look, that should be enough for any Christian. If Jesus goes, he is one, or if Jesus says, pray this way,
of course.
Abba Father, right?" And the person was just, you know, stubborn. I mean,
haven't yet seen that language has meaning and God has revealed himself as a father. Now we know we know he's not a male human being. That's clear. We're not arguing that point. He is a father. The best we can do with fathers is to think, well, what do fathers do? You know, we have various impressions of fathers. He's the ideal father, certainly not a human being. End of story. Nothing to discuss. Okay, then we get to the 18th verse, a ruler. What did this chap have to say? 18. Who's going to do 18?
Once a religious leader asked Jesus this question, "Good teacher, what should I do to get eternal life?" Mm-hmm.
And Jesus said to him, "Why are you calling me good? No one is good except God alone.
You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your father and mother."
The man replied, "I have kept all these commandments since I was young."
When Jesus heard this, he said to the man, you still lack the one thing. Go and sell all you have. Give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Mm-hmm. Then come and follow me.
But when the man heard this, he became sad, because he was very rich.
And Jesus looked at him and said, how hard it is for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God.
For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God.
Those who heard this wondered, who can be saved then?
Yeah.
Jesus replied, what is impossible in human terms is possible for God.
I love the way Jesus answered that. You see, he answered it, don't get to fussing over detail. God can do it. That's enough. I like the way he put an end to that potential argument there. So a ruler then, that would be some sort of an official, I suppose, a church official, whether Jew or Gentile, probably a Jew, questioned him, good teacher, call him good teacher, rabbi, what can I do, what shall I do to inherit the life of the age to come? Let's correct the translations, they're not eternal life, the life of the age to come, the future life of the kingdom. As Tom Wright, Bishop Wright, has in his translation too. That's what that certainly means. The eternal life is the life of the coming age. And Jesus answered him, why are you calling me good? No one is good except God alone. I can remember sitting in a class in California back in 1963, and my brain was saying, well, there you go. Jesus is saying, watch out, I'm God.
Wink, wink.
Wink, wink. I remember that. God has a way of recalling events in your life, by the way.
Wait a minute, how was he telling you to?
He's saying, well, of course I am God.
No one is good except God alone.
No, I meant, are you in your head?
He is God, and therefore Jesus is saying, now be careful when you're saying good. You do realize that I am God, so you're speaking right. That's the way I was processing that. Wow. That's the way Trinitarians process that.
Well, you were a kid, so.
I was over 20. I was sitting in a Bible college, and that's the way my brain was processing. Now I see that quite differently. Why are you calling me good, a person? No one, that's not him, is absolutely good except Isotheos, the one God. The one God. That's beautiful. That's a pure, unitary, monotheistic statement from a Jew. Exactly right. Jesus, yes, was sinless, but being a human being, he had the downward pull of human nature. He wasn't absolutely good in the sense that the Father is completely good, right? He makes a distinction there. He didn't want reverence to himself as reverence to God. He's always avoiding that. When they say, well, you're making yourself equal with God, he carefully says, no, I'm not. I'm God's agent. Yes, his claim is amazing because he's doing the things that God can do under the authority of God, but he's not God himself. That's just absurd. So that's a terrific verse. This is actually parallel to Mark 12:29, where the Jew says to him, what's the greatest commandment? And this is the parallel. Instead of saying the Lord our God is one Lord, they deal with it the same idea. Why do you call me good? Nobody is good except God. That's Jewish, Christian, unitary monotheism. But you know the commandments, do them all. Get on with the commandments, you know those. That's what you're supposed to do to enter the kingdom, of course. He said, I've done all these. Interesting comment, right? I don't think he's saying I'm sinless, but he's saying I've basically done all of this as I should. And I suppose there are people who can say that. When Jesus heard this, he didn't give up on him. He said to him, what you still lack is this. Sell all your possessions and distribute to the poor, and then you will have treasure with God in heaven. That's treasure stored up with God in heaven. In Matthew 6, Jesus said, if you don't pray right, then you have no treasure stored up with God. Doesn't mean you've got the treasure. It's in store for you, waiting to be given to you at the second coming as a reward. But here, this man was obviously bolder than he should have been. In his case, money was the thing keep him out of the kingdom. Does that mean there aren't wealthy people in the Christian faith? There are. First, in Timothy, you'll find that Paul says those who have some degree of riches are to be generous. He doesn't say to sell everything. This particular man's problem was the money was standing before him in the kingdom. I get it. This doesn't mean you all have to be poor. That's absolutely false. Otherwise, Paul would have told the man in 1 Timothy 70. But be generous, certainly. Then God will recognize that. And then come and follow me means be my student, my disciple, and learn the Christian faith from me. But it was too much for this guy. When he heard these things, he got very sad. For he was extremely rich. Interesting, huh? Extremely rich. Then Jesus looked at him and said, how difficult it is for those who are wealthy and are relying on that wealth, of course, to enter the life of the age to come, the kingdom of God in the future. And 25, there was a lot of fuss in scholarship for many years about how this was some gate in Jerusalem. There was a camel's gate or something. And it was very narrow, and so a camel couldn't go through. Probably it's nothing to do with that. Scholarship went on a sort of a fad with that one. Most likely, this is simply a nice joke, right? You can't put a camel through a needle. I try it sometime when you're sewing your thread.
They have.
The eye of a needle. It's Jesus' humor, right? It's a vivid image. It's very difficult. Then, of course, they immediately argued with him and said, well, who in the world can get saved? Please note that getting saved is not going to heaven. It's entering the kingdom of God. It's entering the life of the age to come. Who can get saved, they said. They didn't say, well, who can go to heaven? Because nobody ever said that in the Bible. That's not part of what they say or think. And Jesus answered it in a nice, general, put an end to all arguments. You let God get on with that. You know, you do what you're supposed to do, and everything is possible with God. End of argument. He didn't let it go any further. Now we're getting to a fantastically interesting passage, 28, unless there's any other comment on that.
Well, can I just comment on the Es?
Yes, one.
Or Theos.
Es or Theos, right?
One the God, literally. Yeah. Now, if you pointed to the Shema, the Shema basically has the same formulation. And if you do a word study or if you study deeper into these things, you'll see that that means, as you say, and as you translate in some parts of your Bible,
one person.
Of course. In other words, the Shema describes one person, God.
Of course.
So,
one Yahweh, one Father.
So the question to ask people, all billion of them, Catholic Protestants,
the whole lot,
is how can you have three persons in one person? Yeah. Because in the Shema, the great creed, Jesus' creed, is Otheos, one, the God is one person. So I'll ask people.
That's a great question.
Trying
to Es Otheos is standard for the one person God, if you like. The one person God, Es Otheos. And Luke also has, earlier in Luke, maybe you could find the verse for us, he has the only God, Monos Otheos. Where is that? Luke 4?
Monos.
Luke 4, I think. Or Luke 5. Monos Otheos, he's looking it up with this amazing software. Monos Otheos. That's the type it's Greek in.
Luke 4?
4, and verse?
Worship the Lord your God and serve him only? No.
Not quite. Monos, look up the Greek, monos o theos.
No.
Type in monos, type o, and theos. You don't have the Bible works there, that's fine. I'm just showing you how these tools are so amazing. The Bible works, Hermeneutica Bible works. You've got 60 languages, you've got the Greek and the Hebrew, it's very, very accessible stuff. Anyway, it's in the earlier chapters of Luke.
Luke 5:21, the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this anthropos, man, who speaks blasphemies? Yeah. Who can forgive sins but God, this version has, monos or theos, God alone.
Only God. See, monos said, doesn't that mean we say one God? Or only God, one and only God, it's not a problem. It was never designed to be other than an encouragement, enlightenment for everybody.
Well, again, if you do a word study on monos or mono, well, this is just good to have handy for me anyway. The point being, you cannot have more than one person be monos. Mono, you know, be alone. You know, Lord is alone. It's one person.
Your child understands that. She said to a two-year-old, so, Mommy, why are you explaining this to me? Perfectly honest. Perfectly honest. President is the only president of USA. Everybody should
I'm
know.
I'm not preaching to the converted here. I'm preaching to our audience out there.
These are good arguments that they can use to help their friends. Okay, what do we do next then? We're getting on to the resurrection.
What verse?
He took the 12 disciples. Oh, not there. Are we there?
28.
Oh, Peter. Who's got 28? Okay, Barbara, maybe? 28th of the 18th of Luke. Mm-hmm.
Peter said, "We have left our homes and followed you."
And he said to them, "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God,
who will not receive many times as much at this time and in the age to come eternal life."
Okay, that's very easy stuff. Peter said, look, we've given up everything to be your disciples, to be your followers. We've given up our homes and we've taken on discipleship. And it's pretty tough because we're up against it. The establishment doesn't like us, Jesus. This is hard going. And Jesus replied, "Truly, I tell you, no one who's left house, there's things that are dear to us, right? Or wife, even. Or brothers, or parents, or children. For the sake of the kingdom of God, that is. For the greater cause of the kingdom of God. Who will not receive many times as much at this time." Note that, at this time. "And in the age to come, the life of that age to come." Of course, in the life to come, you get the life that belongs to the age to come. Now, in the Mark version, go to Mark 10:29. It's even clearer. It's shocking to people, Mark 10:29. It's all the 29s here, if I remember. Mark 10:29, you have this, which says, "Truly I tell you, there's no one who's left house or brothers or sister," he doesn't mention husband and wife here, "sisters or mother or father or children or farms for my sake," the other version was "for the sake of the kingdom," same thing, "or for the gospel's sake," there's the gospel of the kingdom, "that he will receive 100 times as much now in the present age, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, and children, and farms, along with persecutions," that's the downside, "and in the age to come, the life of the age to come." Now I see why he didn't mention wives and husbands, right? Because he couldn't, in this phrase, he couldn't have said you'll receive now more wives and husbands. Got it? Oh, that occurred to me to write that. That's why he didn't mention the husband and wives in that quotation of the statement. Wow. That's neat. Isn't that amazing? So you don't have to become impoverished and sell every last straw that you own, but it better not be in the way of entering the kingdom.
It's not like Trump said, it's not that money is the root of the evil.
No.
It's the love of money.
It's the love of money. Exactly. Well, that's right. The text in Timothy says that money is a root of all evil. It's not the only root of evil, obviously. It's good stuff. All right, back to Luke 18,
31,
what have we got here? Then he took the 12, Sarah's turn.
Then he took the 12 aside and said to them, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and all things which are written through the prophets about the Son of Man will be accomplished."
Yes.
"He will be handed over to the foreigners. He will be mocked, insulted, and spat upon.
They will flog him and kill him. But on the third day, he will rise again."
Okay, stopping there. This is the third occasion in which he announces his death. It's worth mentioning that the first time he does that is in Matthew 16. Just keep that verse handy, because Matthew 16 I've got the wrong verse, I'm sorry. It's 21. It's Matthew 16:21. For the first time, Jesus began to show, this is Matthew 16:21, his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things and get killed and rise on the third day. That's amazing. He had not mentioned that until that juncture. And then two and three times, the third time in this case, we're looking at the Lucan one, he repeats this. They didn't get it clear, but that's what he said. On the third day, and that Sunday, having been killed on the Friday, and Sunday is the third day since Friday. That's Luke 24:21. Today, Sunday, is the third day since Friday. But the disciples didn't get it. That's amazing. And yet they'd been preaching the gospel along with Jesus. They didn't yet take in the awful prospect of the Messiah dying. The meaning was hidden from them in God's providence, however that is. They didn't comprehend the things that were said. Isn't that amazing?
And this was the third time.
This is the third time. Still didn't. Now, even when he was raised from the dead, some of them didn't believe. Remember that? Mm-hmm. Takes a bit of believing to have breakfast with somebody you know died the day before, doesn't it? Takes a bit of believing. With God, though, all things are very easy and possible.
Can you, yeah. I don't know if you have, if you have it in your notes, but Jesus refers to the scriptures.
Yeah.
Can you tell us where there are prophecies of the third day?
Of the third day, of course, yes. There's one in Hosea, isn't it? Which is the verse in Hosea. Yes, Hosea 6:1. Let's see. What is that? Third day.
Then on the third day, the Messiah. 6:2, is it?
6:2. What is it? Hosea.
After 2 days, he will revive us. Right. On the third day, he will restore us.
What's that? 6:2?
6:2.
Yeah. Okay, and they understood that. That's Israel. No problem. Jesus is Israel, represents them, so they would connect that. That's probably where they got it from.
Do you have other arguments?
No.
No. That's it.
The third day, no, that would be the
anyway. The scriptures are about his suffering in general, I think.
Yes.
Everything that's written through the prophets about the Son of Man will be accomplished. Good. So his suffering, his death, Psalm 22, Isaiah 53.
Right, the suffering
is
pretty.
It's Isaiah 53, third day, only in Hosea expressly.
He's also pointing to a third day that the prophets spoke about, or is it just...
Only that one expressly, only that one deliberately. But there may be other arguments you could get for the third day, I don't know, in the prophets. Okay. But as Sarah says, it's much broader than just the third day. It's all about the suffering. That's Isaiah 53, the suffering servant. Okay, that's a good point. But they didn't understand it at this stage. Now we come to a wonderful prayer to Jesus text coming up right here. As Jesus was approaching Jericho, verse 35 for us. Shall I do that? Oh, maybe Vicky could do 35. What do you got there?
Sure.
Thank you.
As Jesus was approaching Jericho, a blind man was sitting beside the road begging.
Yes. 36.
When he heard the noise of a crowd going past, he asked what was happening. Mm-hmm.
They told him that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by.
And he called out, saying, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me."
Jesus stopped and told them to bring the blind man to him.
Yeah.
As he came over, Jesus asked him,
41.
"What do you want me to do for you?" He pleaded. "Lord, please, I want to be able to see."
And Jesus said, "All right, you can see. Your faith has healed you."
That's wonderful. And 43, immediately he regained his sight and began following him, glorifying God. And when all the people saw it, they gave praise to God. It was a happy day, wasn't it?
But he didn't ask for his autograph.
Maybe they couldn't write. I don't know about that.
It's like a movie star. You know?
Yeah, he's a movie star. Now I want to refer you in that wonderful plea in 39. He kept crying out all the more. You see, the disciples were very wooden and legalistic. "Oh, tell this man to get away. He's bothering us." You see that? Isn't that interesting? And the rabbi has a far more generous approach. And the man then keeps crying out all the more. I like that sternly. 39. Those who led the way were sternly telling him, you can imagine the language they were using, to be quiet. But he kept on crying out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." You can pray that way too. He's still the son of David. Back in Matthew 15:22, you want to link these verses. In Matthew 15:22, lady from Tyre and Sidon, a pagan lady, Canaanite woman, came out and began to cry out, saying, "Have mercy on me, Lord, son of David." Isn't that marvelous? You see, she understood who he was. She's not calling on God here. She's calling on the Son of David, the Lord's Son of David. Her theology was right. And that helped her prayers a lot. She knew who he was. Matthew subtly telling us that. And then parallel to that one in Matthew 20, verse 30, I think over in Matthew 20, verse 30. Two blind men now. I love these verses. Two blind men sitting by the road, hearing that Jesus was passing by, cried out, Lord, have mercy on us, Son of David. Isn't that beautiful? Son of David. He's not the ancestor of David. You can't be older than your own ancestors. He's the son of David. They knew that. So the idea of pre-existing himself is really incoherent. He's the child of David, the seed of David. You have to be that to be the Messiah. That's very clear. So you get the same thing here. And you say, well, where's the Lord here? Well, it's down in verse 41. What do you want me to do for you? And he said, Lord, Kyrie. Now you can remember this. Kyrie, the word Lord, goes for a whole range of ranks. God is the Lord. So is Jesus. And so is the gardener when Mary Magdalene says, they've taken away my Lord. Where have they put him? She thinks she's talking to the gardener. Kyrie. Isn't that wonderful? A range of topics. People all hung out, oh, this word is this and that. Oh, come on. This is a range, a flexibility of language, which is so delightful. And you can cry out then, Lord, Son of David, have mercy upon me. That's in the Roman Catholic Mass. You know that. When they're singing the Mass, they're singing, Kyrie eleison. That's biblical language. Lord, have mercy. That's in their favor. Kyrie eleison eme. That's have mercy on me. These are the words of the blind man. That's a beautiful contact with Scripture. Son of David, have mercy upon me. I want to see again, isn't it? Well, that's complicated, isn't it? No, I'd like to see. You know, everybody else can see. Can I see too, please? You can imagine the child with his hand up. Jesus said, your sight comes back to you. Receive your sight. Your faith. Well done, you, please note. Oh, we don't like that. You know, God did glorify God. Yes, we do that. They also are glorifying God. Your faith has saved you. It's worth having faith. Your faith has saved you. Has made you well. Has saved you. Yes, made you well. Literally, saved you. Please note that to be made well in health terms is to be saved. Because when you're sick, you're going near to death. And you need to be rescued from death. That's what salvation is. So if you're not in good health, you're getting a little closer to death. So your faith has healed you. That's wonderful. Saved you. And immediately got his sight back. And everybody glorified God. It was a good day, wasn't it? I love that. It was a good day because you get so tired of this opposition. The church is always against it.
Nobody argued.
Nobody wanted to parse the Greek words.
I think the Pharisees weren't there at this occasion, so they didn't. Yeah.
Well, actually, the opposite is true. Randy brings up a good point.
Okay.
That people petitioning, asking, or praying to Jesus to do all these things, there was no confusion.
No.
They gave praise to God.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that reminds me of a good verse in Matthew 9, if I could read it, when he heals someone here.
Yeah.
He heals a cripple, a paralyzed man.
Yes.
And then I guess the Pharisee was here this day because someone yelled out, "You're speaking blasphemy."
Yes.
Why? And then Jesus said, "Why are you thinking wicked things? What's easier to say? Your sins are forgiven, or get up and walk." Anyway, the point is the verse 8. When the crowd saw what had happened, they were scared. Then they praised God that he had given human beings such a large measure of power.
Marvelous.
That's the one God, one Father, one.
That's one. That's one. Okay.
So Randy also said,
praise goes to God, and praise goes to God for the authority given to man on this occasion.
I also had a question, Anthony, if you have any notes about this, or off the top of your head, or anyone here, because I don't know. Old Testament scripture where the son of David was going to perform all these type of things? Are there any scripture?
No, Jewish literature, I think, thinks of David as doing all sorts of. I don't have any miracle.
Healer, miracle.
Not healing, but he did get a stone and kill a giant, and that's something of a miracle.
Because it sounds by the way the people are reacting that they, it's the son of David. Yes. You know, he'll heal me. So it sounds like there's some background there. I don't know if there's.
Yeah. Any. Well, there may be in Jewish tradition there. That's a good point. We'll find that. That David was viewed as a healer. It's not mentioned in scripture. We know that he makes musical instruments.
Or just as a.
Yeah.
The one is in Isaiah 61.
Mm-hmm. 61?
61.
Yeah. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind.
Excellent.
There you go. Specifically.
Good.
To set free those who are downtrodden to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord.
So that's Messiah, a prophecy of Messiah. Excellent.
So they have that in their head, these people, obviously.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So Messiah? Because the other point we have to make is that the son of David equals
Messiah.
We tend to disconnect those two. Again, it's all disconnection.
61, what was it, sir?
61, 1?
One and two, I think.
Recovery of sight to the blind, that's beautiful.
The
There's
one he quotes when he comes out of the desert.
Yes.
Right.
Luke, actually, at the beginning.
Right.
So Luke sets it up, actually, from the start. That
You're right about the disconnect. The whole of this problematic system we've been brought up in is that it disconnects Jesus from Messiah. You know, the Spanish have Jesucristo. They've turned it into one word, Jesucristo. And so the joke is, the child thinks that Mary and Joseph Christ had a baby, Jesus Christ. Mr. and Mrs. Christ had a baby, Jesus Christ. That's the way a child will hear that. However, Christ is, of course, anointed one. What you've not been allowed to see is that the anointed one, even in the plural, anointed ones, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, are called messiahs, plural. You haven't been allowed to see that. Don't touch my anointed ones. That's a correct translation. It's also messiahs. When you get over to the New Testament, you avoid the word anoint and you put messiah. Therefore, the brain makes a disconnect. It doesn't see that Jesus is the ultimate anointed one. So let's finish with this marvelous text for your neighbors in Luke 2:11. Luke 2:11. Luke is outstanding in his teaching, very methodical. Here then the birth certificate of who Jesus is. This is why they got their sight back, because they understood it. Luke 2:11. The angel said to them in 2:10, don't be scared. I'm bringing good news, I like that, friendly angel, of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today, let's argue about today, let's not. Today means the day on which the angel was speaking. Today in the city of David, that's Bethlehem, everybody knew that, there's been born for you a Savior who is, the Greek says, the Messiah Lord. The Messiah Lord, Christ the Lord if you like, but even better, the Messiah Lord, or even better, the anointed Lord, you see? God was not anointed. Priests and kings are anointed. To say that that meant the Lord God was born is worse than stupid. It's very, very poor in our technological age. It's terribly bad. No, he's the Messiah Lord. Anyway, that Messiah Lord phrase is found in the Psalms of Solomon. These are not biblical books, but they're written 50 BC. Jews knew what this meant, you see. It's a Jewish book. We'll tell all of this, by the way, in the mosque. All of what I'm saying here, we'll go through this with our friends, the Muslim people. They like a lot of this because the Quran does think that Jesus is the Messiah. Okay.
So you always have Luke 2:21 and Luke 2:26.
Yes, Luke 2:11 and 2:26.
I'm sorry, 2:11 and
2:26 says he's the Lord's Messiah. So you have those two together, Luke 2:11 and Luke 2:26. That's wonderfully well done. Luke gets an A++ for his systematic writing here. He's the Messiah Lord, and he's also Yahweh's anointed. So was Saul. So was King David. Then you are reconnecting the Hebrew Bible with the new, and you're beginning to make sense of it. Anyway, a lot of work to do. Tell those 1.5 billion Muslims, 1 billion Catholics and everybody think of, and we'll make some progress. Anything else anybody wants to say? We're about to head for on the road to Tennessee, so we need your prayers that we can be safe driving all the way to Pigeon Forge. Do come back. See